Well, good morning, church. We're so glad to be here with you this morning in worship. If you're able, would you stand as we read our call to worship from Psalm 63, verses 1 through 4. It says, "You, God, are my God. Earnestly I seek you. I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you in a dry and parched land where there is no water. I have seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory. Because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I will praise you as long as I live. And in your name, I will lift up my hands." We've waited for this day. We've gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, will burn our hearts with truth. Your love brings you where we
Well, good morning, everyone. How y'all doing? Everybody doing well? Yes. You look fantastic. I know we have a big school year that is coming up this Thursday, right? I believe all of our teachers and our employees go back to school. We want to wish you guys a very great school year. Our students, they are so excited about going back to class. Said no student ever, right? But we want to pray for them as well. It's a bittersweet day for us because Leslie and I have some of our dear friends, Don and Rosita Whitt, here with us today. We get to hear from Don as he preaches a really great message from Matthew chapter 7, if you want to start turning. But it's also a bittersweet day in that we say goodbye to Karen Mitchell today at 2, if you'd like to join us for her funeral at Hastings. And then tomorrow we say goodbye to Elsie Kemp at Horace Ward Seminary, Cemetery up in, seminary is a lot like cemetery, as a matter of fact. Freudian slip. But seriously, up at Horace Ward Funeral Home and Cemetery, we will have a homegoing service for Elsie Kemp, and then we'll lay her to rest at the graveside. But it's a bittersweet day for us at First Baptist Church. If you're a guest with us, you are very, very special to us. We want to welcome you to First Baptist Church. We hope you have a great experience here today. By the way, we were at dinner with the Whitts last night. We met a young lady named Kaija. I don't know if she's here. Is Kaija here? No, okay. She said she was going to try to make it. But I also had a really neat opportunity to meet one of Brenda Bear's new friends, Luvi, from the Philippines. And she is a new teacher at McDonough High School. Welcome to our community. Welcome to First Baptist Church. If you are a guest, though, and maybe we've never had an opportunity to reach out to you, drop you something into the mail, maybe send you an email or something, would you take the Connect card in the pew rack in front of you, fill that out for us if you would, and drop that into the offering plate when the offering plate comes to you today. Or you could take out your phone and look at the QR code in front of you, and you can register your visit with us online. We would love, though, to thank you for being here with us today. Our men are going to come forward now to take the morning offering. It's an opportunity for our members to give back a portion of what God has given us, and we are so grateful. If you'd like to sow into the ministry of Don and Rosita Whitt as they take the gospel to the world, we hope that you'll consider doing that with a love offering envelope in the pew rack in front of you as well. But we're going to have a word of prayer for our teachers and students and for the Mitchell and Kemp families. And we're going to move forward with why we're here. And that is to worship our Lord. Amen. Let's pray together. Father, we come to you so incredibly grateful for the blessing of life and grace and mercy that you give us. We're so undeserving. We were talking about this earlier. All we like sheep have gone astray. And yet by your grace, you call us back home and into relationship with you through your son Jesus, who died and rose from the dead. And so we come together today as a church family to say thank you for all you've done for us. Thank you, God, for sending your son Jesus to save us. Thank you for the fellowship that we all have here together. We pray your blessings upon First Baptist. We pray your blessings upon this offering that is to be given today to help underwrite this ministry. And God, today we turn our hearts to the Mitchell, Mayo, and the Kemp families as they gather in McDonough this weekend to remember their loved ones, as we remember the life of Karen Mitchell, this precious saint and servant who so faithfully served you here, and this wonderful, amazing woman named Elsie, who, that tremendous personality of hers just had us wrapped around her finger, just in love with this sweet woman. And God, we just pray your blessings on their families, on all of the the intricacies and the moving parts of a funeral service. We pray that it would all go well for the family, so they don't have to worry about any of that. They can just gather with friends and celebrate the lives of their loved ones. But we thank you so much for Karen and Elsie and the impact they made on us. We'll never forget them. And God, as we close today, we want to thank you for another school year ahead. The tremendous impact that teachers and school employees and others, moms and dads and students, what we think of the impact that our teachers and employees have on students' lives. So many times when I've had the opportunity to talk with those influencers in young people's lives, God, you know, so many of those students say it was a teacher. Someone who taught them not only the curriculum, but about life itself. So I thank you so much for all of our godly Christian teachers. Thank you so much for the teachers at our fellowship. And we pray your blessings on them. Give them strength. Give them stamina. Give them whatever it takes to make it through another year. And God, when they're having a weak day and the kids are out of control and nothing seems to go right, God, we pray that you would help them to overcome. Give them a strength they have not of themselves, but your strength, a superhuman strength. Lord, we pray for our students that they would begin now to sort of focus their attention on a school year ahead and on learning and on what it is they will discover this year. How each and every year is built upon another, and how you'll use it to develop our young minds so that they can grow up and take on the world and become all that you intended they become. Find their true purpose, and that this education of their lives will have been a blessing to them, not a burden. God, what we do is we pray all of your blessings. And on your servant Don today, as he shares a message from your word, open our hearts to your truth, to the life that is in these words. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. You're my comfort, my shelter, tower, refuge, and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing.
Jesus. For us on the cross so that we could know you, so that we could live in a personal relationship with you. We thank you so much for that, for your grace and your mercy.
Father, as we continue throughout this worship service this morning, we ask that you would be here with us, that you would speak to us, that you would open our hearts and our minds to be ready to receive your word this morning. Lord, we pray for Don as he comes this morning with your word. We ask that you would speak to him this morning, that he would be a vessel for you and you alone. We want to honor and glorify you here in this place. We love you and we praise you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Well, amen and amen. Good to be back with you here at First Baptist Church. And I love your pastor. Amen. Your pastor and Miss Leslie are special, special people to us. And Brother Charles, again, thank you for allowing us to get to be here. This is one of our favorite places to preach. And we love to come here with you. We travel. Rosita and I travel week after week. We'll be in 44 different revivals or crusades in America this year. I don't know what I'm going to do when I get older, but this will be 44 and planning 40 plus again next year. We've already been in Ethiopia once this year and had a little over 103,000 people saved in 2 weeks there. And so God is really moving, blessing. And look forward to next year. We're going to be going next year in June to the Philippines. And I'm going to get your name right. Luti? Luvi. Yes. I got it. Luvi. And my wife is half Filipino. Her father came from the Philippines years and years ago. And a very unique story. And his brother, who was an older teenager, already had a visa to come to America. And he got cold feet. And so Rosita's father said, I want to go. And so he took his brother's visa. You know, they looked alike. And so he came here to America, took his brother's name, and became an American citizen later. But this was years ago, and you remember the Japanese attacked the Philippines. And his father, his mother, that brother, that sister, and family were all killed. And if he had stayed there, there'd been no Rosita. But she's never been to the Philippines, and we've always had a burden to go back there. So we're excited about going back, and we'll be able to do the same thing in the Philippines that we've been doing in Ethiopia. And then later on in the year, next year, in August and September, Charles and Leslie and me and Rosita, we're planning on going back either to Ethiopia or Uganda, one or the other. And we'll be doing the same things that we've been doing the crusades and doing the market preaching. So we're excited about that. But again, thank you for allowing us to get to be here with you all today. We look forward to what God is going to do today. Take your Bibles now and open them to Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7, and I'm going to read there, verse 13 down through verse 23. Matthew chapter 7, beginning in verse 13. And if you're ready for the word of God, say amen. Amen. Jesus said, enter ye at the strait gate, wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. And many there be which go in thereat. Because straight is gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be that find it. Beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. You shall know them by their fruits. The men gather grapes of thorns or figs of thistles. Even so, every good tree bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Every tree that bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. Wherefore, by their fruits you shall know them. Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father, which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? And them will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Let's pray together. Father, we already sense your presence in this place. I thank you for the songs that have been sung, the truths that have been presented. And God, how true that is. There is nothing but the blood. It's only through the blood of Christ that we have our sins washed away. Now, Lord, I do pray right now for that man, that woman, that boy, that girl that's in this building that is nearest to hell. I pray today they'll come to Christ and be saved. Holy Spirit of God, we welcome you to move in this place. Walk up and down these aisles, in and out these pews. And when the invitation's extended in a few moments, may there be a freedom for people to respond to your call. I do pray that what takes place here will bring joy in heaven. May your perfect will be accomplished. May the name of Jesus be honored. In Christ's name I pray, and all God's people say, amen. These are the very words of Jesus. Now, all the Bible is the inspired, the inerrant, the infallible, perfect Word of God. Amen? But these are the very words of Jesus himself. Now, as Jesus is speaking to his congregation, he is saying there's some things that you need to know about eternity. He is saying there's some things that you need to take hold of before you leave this life. Now, the message today is going to be applicable to you who are Christians. The Bible says that we're to go into the world and preach the gospel to every creature. You have loved ones. You have friends. You have people that you work with. You have people you go to school with. You have neighbors who are not saved. And we have no option. We must take the gospel to them. And then also, this message is going to be applicable to you who are not saved. The Bible says it's appointed a man once to die, but after this, the judgment. We do not know when we're going to die. If you're here today and you're lost, and you die in that condition, you're going to be held accountable for what I'm going to preach today. I mean, one day you're going to come face to face, eyeball to eyeball, before Jesus. And you're going to have to give an account for what you're going to hear and what you would have heard if you had listened. And then one day at the great white throne judgment, you're going to stand before God and you're going to have to admit, yes, I should have been saved there at First Baptist Church when Don Whitt was preaching, but I rejected Christ and I'm guilty. Now, in this passage, we find some sobering statements. Now, no doubt you have thought about these statements, and no doubt you've heard preachers preach what I'm going to be preaching about today. This message is not unique, but it's very simple, but also it's very profound. Let's look at them. Number one, There is a hell. There's some people who say that God has already determined who's going to go to heaven and who's going to go to hell. That's a lie out of hell. Amen? John 3:16, let's say it together. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. 2 Peter 3:9, God said that he's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. It is God's will for every person to be saved. I can look at everyone on this side today and say, it's God's will for you to be saved. I can look at every person over here and say, it's God's will for you to be saved. Brother Charles, as we go into the jungles of Africa, we can look at every person there and say, it's God's will for you to be saved. It is not God's will that any person go to hell. If you go to hell, you're going to go there as an intruder. The Bible says in Matthew 25, verse 41, that hell was prepared for the devil and his angels. It is not God's intent that any person die and go to hell. But if you reject Christ, the Bible says in Isaiah 5:14 that hell hath enlarged herself and hath opened her mouth without measure. In other words, if you die lost, there will be room in hell for you. Luke 16, the Bible tells us about a man who lifted up his eyes and he was in hell. And he cried out and said, I'm tormented in this flame. The Bible says in Matthew 22, 13, that hell is a place of outer darkness. That hell is a place where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Mark 9, 44 says that hell is a place where the worm dieth not and the fire is not quenched. I heard about a preacher. They came upon a group of bikers, and he began to witness to them. And one of the bikers was sort of smart aleck, and he said, oh, preacher. He said, I'm just going to go ahead and die lost and go on to hell, and then I'll be able to party there with my buddies. And so the preacher went over to this guy and laid his hand on his shoulder, and he began to pray. And he said, now, Lord, this man says that he wants to die and go to hell so he can, so to speak, party with his buddies. So, God, I pray right now that you will let a bolt of lightning come down and strike him dead and take him on to hell so he can, so to speak, party with his buddies as he thinks he would. And that man looked back at the preacher and said, you crazy? Listen, you may act tough, but you won't be in hell 1 second. And you'll realize the reality of hell. Jesus said to the poor and to the rich, to the educated and the uneducated, if you die lost, it's not that you won't pass go and not that you won't collect $200. Listen, this is not Monopoly. This is not a game. But if you die lost, you're going to wake up in the flames of hell forever and forever. Now, I realize you don't hear that preached a lot today. I'm certain that you hear it from this pulpit. Amen. You hear it from this pulpit. But even in our Baptist churches, I'm Baptist, so I can talk to us Baptists. Now, whatever the other people do, that's them. But I do know Baptist. And there is a subtle universalism that has crept into our Baptist churches today. That is that they have the idea that ultimately God's not going to let anyone go to hell, but everyone's going to get to go to heaven. That's a lie. I was preaching in a church. I'm not going to tell you the name of the church. You would recognize it, and you would recognize the name of that pastor. I preached there one Sunday morning. We had 30-something people get saved. God moved. And I was out in the foyer after the service was over, and I had my books with me that day. And I don't sell books. I give them away. And so whatever anybody wants to give us, we use it for our mission projects and mission trips. So I was there, and there was one of the men came up to me. He was an attorney. He was one of their deacons. And he said to me, I've been a member here of this church for over 20 years. And he said, my three teenagers got saved today. And he said, I'd like to have four of your books. And he said, if you will, please sign each one of the three books and put my teenager's name on each one of the books. And he gave them to me and put this day's date and sign your name so they'll never forget this day. And then he said, I'd like to have one of the books. I said, love to do it. And then he looked at me and he said, I've been a member of this church for over 20 years. I love my pastor. I love him. But he said, today was the first time that I've heard the subject of hell preached from that pulpit in the 20 years that I've been here. There's a subtle universalism that has crept into many of our churches today, which says, in essence, everybody's going to get to go to heaven. That's not true. There is a hell. And then sobering statement number two. Not everyone is going to be saved. Notice verse 13 and verse 14 again. Look at it. Jesus said, enter ye at the straight gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. And many there be which go in thereat, because straight is the gate and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life. And few there be that find it. Did you notice he begins to divide the saved and the lost, the sheep and the goats, those who are blessed and those that are damned, those that are going down that broad way to destruction, and those that are going that narrow way which leads to life. Jesus is saying not everyone is going to be saved. You know, there's a strong possibility that there's someone here, or maybe even several, who'll go to hell. You know, that's awful to even think about. But there is a possibility that there's people here in this room right now that will spend an eternity in hell with the devil and his demons. It may be that person sitting next to you. It may even be you, unless you give your heart to Christ. You say, preacher, don't you believe that everyone is a child of God? No. Everyone is a creation of God, but only those who have been born again are the children of God. Jesus said to the most religious people of his day, the Pharisees, you are of your father, the devil. You say, well, I'm a good boy. Don't count. I'm a good girl. Don't count. Mom and daddy are Christians. Don't count. I got baptized. Don't count. I'm a church member. Don't count. I'm a Baptist. That sure don't count. I'm a Methodist. I'm a Presbyterian. I'm an Assembly of God. I'm a Catholic. Don't count. Jesus is the only one who can get you into heaven. Jesus said in John 14:6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. Jesus said in John 10:10, I am come that they might have life, and they might have it more abundantly. Jesus said in John 10:9, I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved. Jesus said in John 11:25, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet he shall live. Jesus is not an option. He's the only way to heaven. Allah will send you to hell. Buddha will send you to hell. Confucius will send you to hell. The New Age religion will send you to hell. John 1:12. But as many as receive him, that's Jesus, to them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. Acts 4:12. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Listen, this salvation is not Burger King religion. Have it your way. Listen, this is Wendy's. Old-fashioned, hot and juicy. Amen and amen. And then sobering statement number 3. More people are going to be lost than are going to be saved. Notice again there in Matthew 7:13-14. Jesus said, broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. Because straight is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life, and few there be which find it. Did you notice? Many are going down that broad way. Few are going down that straight and narrow way. I'm convinced that one of the greatest mission fields in the world are the church roles of America. People who have church membership, but they're not members of the family of God. People who have joined the church, but they've not joined Jesus. Years ago, I was pastor of the North Athens Baptist Church in Athens, Tennessee. It was a Sunday evening. I'd already finished my message, and I was standing here extending an invitation. And I noticed one of my deacons, Gene Pierman, was sitting about three-fourths of the way back on this side. He stepped out, walked down the side, walked over to me, stood right in front of me, and he looked at me and he said, Pastor, I've come tonight to make my public profession of faith, and I need to follow the Lord in believer's baptism. And I looked at him, I said, Gene, what in the world are you talking about? He said, well, me and Barbara got married when we were just older teenagers. We had no church background. But he said, we'd been married for a couple of months, and one Saturday morning, there was a knock at our door, and we went there, and it was a pastor. And he said, I'd like to come in and visit with you. And he said, we invited him in. We sat down on the couch, and he looked over at me, and he said, now, wouldn't you love to become a Christian? And he said, I looked back, and I said, but anyone with good sense would want to be a Christian. And he said, that pastor knelt there beside my couch, and he said, well, I'm going to pray that you will become a Christian. And he said he prayed and prayed that I would become a Christian. And then he stood up and he said, now you're a Christian. He said he was a preacher. He's supposed to know what it means to be a Christian. He said, I went to church the next Sunday morning, and I told him I had become a Christian. And they told me that I need to follow the Lord in baptism. So he said, I got baptized. And I got active in the church and began to work in Sunday school. And that church had a big bus ministry. Y'all remember years ago when churches had big bus ministries? Y'all remember that? And we had a big, big bus ministry. And Gene became one of the bus captains. I mean, he packed that bus out every week. He had more on his bus than any of the other buses. And then he was made a deacon in our church. But he said, every time we'd have revival, I realized there was something that wasn't right. And he said, I would come to the altar, and he said, I would try to rededicate. But he said, I soon realized you cannot rededicate something that's never been dedicated in the first place. And he said, this afternoon at 2:30, I came here, and he pointed over on this side. And he said, I got on my knees and I buried my face there in that carpet. And I cried out to God and asked God to forgive me of my sin. And I asked Jesus to come in my heart and save me. And he said, he saved me. And he said, I've come here tonight to make my public profession of faith and follow the Lord in believer's baptism. I believe I'm looking at some people like that this morning. You have become a church member, but you've never been saved. And you need the same thing to happen to you that happened to Gene Pierman on that Sunday afternoon. And then sobering statement number 4. There will be many who think they're saved who will be lost. Notice again there. Beginning in verse 21, Jesus said, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name? And in thy name cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works. Lord, did not I preach in your name? Did not I sing in your name? Did not I teach in your name? Lord, did not I do all of these things in the church? I mean, Lord, look at all that I've done. And them and I will profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Did you notice what they're talking about? They're only speaking about what they had done. They're not saying anything about what Christ had done for them. The Bible says in Ephesians 2:8-9, for by grace are you saved through faith. That not of you says, it is the gift of God. Not of works, lest any man should boast. Titus 3:5, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he has saved us. What do we mean when we say we're saved by grace? One of the best stories I've heard through the years, I heard years and years ago, about an older preacher that was teaching a group of junior boys and junior girls in Sunday school. Now, most of you don't have the slightest idea in the world what I'm talking about when I talk about juniors, you know, intermediates, primaries, beginners. How many of y'all understand that language? Okay, all the old people. I mean, most of them don't understand, but, you know, this was a group of junior boys, junior girls, you know, he was teaching them, and he was teaching them the difference between works and grace. And he said he was having a hard time getting them to understand that. He said later on that week, it was a cold winter day, snow on the ground, and And he was walking through the city park on his way to conduct a wedding. And this was years ago, you know, when preachers would wear long-tailed coats and high-top hats. And there was a little boy out of that Sunday school class by the name of Johnny. Every church has a Johnny. You know who he is here, don't you? You got him pegged? I believe I met him too. And so little Johnny had the idea, man, it sure would be fun to get a snowball and knock that preacher's hat off his head. And so he got him a snowball and he threw the snowball, but rather than hitting the hat, it hit that preacher right between the eyes. Went all over his face. He got upset and he started to chase after the little boy. And finally he stopped. He said, no, I've been trying to teach them the difference between works and grace. And he went on and conducted the wedding. And he began to think, you know, Johnny likes to fish. So he went downtown to the hardware store and he bought a fishing pole. And he went over to Johnny's house, knocked on the front door. When he knocked on the front door, little Johnny ran out the back door. And Johnny's mother came to the door and the preacher said, is Johnny here? And she said, well, he was here, but I don't know where he is now. He said, well, tell him that I have brought him here this fishing pole. And I want him to have it. I give it to him freely. It's his. That next Sunday morning, he was standing in front of that class of junior boys and junior girls. And he asked the question, is there anyone here that can tell me what grace is? Little Johnny held his hand up. He said, I can. He said, well, Johnny, what's grace? And he said, grace is a fishing pole. Listen, if he got what he deserved, he would have got the licking of his life. But instead, he got grace. Oh, thank God today. If I got what I deserve and you got what you deserve, we'd get hell. But thank God. Praise God. Jesus took my hell. He took your hell when he died there on Calvary's cross. He took my sin. He took your sin when he shed his blood and washed away our sin on that day. Amen and amen. Sometimes I will ask people, are you a Christian? And they will respond by saying, I'm trying to be. I'm doing the best I know how. Listen, the Bible makes it very, very clear that if you're trying to be saved by keeping the Ten Commandments, by being a good church member, by giving money to the church, that you're lost. Because these things do not save. Why is it that these people could not be saved by works? And why is it that we cannot be saved by works? Well, one reason is this. God has determined that Jesus and Jesus alone is going to get glory for our redemption in heaven. I mean, if God were to let a lost person get into heaven, especially if we were to be a lost Baptist, bragging about what all they've done to get into heaven, it'd ruin it for the rest of us. And then the second reason we cannot be saved by works, you would have to live a perfect life from the cradle to the grave. Is there anyone here who has never sinned? James 2:10. If we keep the whole law, and yet we offended in one point, we're guilty of all. The Bible says we've all sinned and come short of the glory of God. The Bible says if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. Now, if you want to know that you're not perfect, just ask your wife. Just ask your wife. Amen. Now, don't walk out of here today and say, well, that preacher says that it does not matter whether I live right or not. That's not what I'm saying. You do not live right in order to be saved. You live right, you live a good life because you have been saved. When you get saved, your life is different. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Listen, when you get saved, you're different. Not perfect. Not going to be perfect until you go to be with Jesus one day. Amen? But you're different. You talk different. You walk different. You think different. I believe you even smell different. You're different. When you get saved, you don't stay the same. You're different. When you get saved, you don't stay a drunkard. When you get saved, you don't stay a sodomite. When you get saved, you don't stay a drug addict. When you get saved, you don't stay a prostitute. Don't bow your head. Look up here. I ain't finished yet. You're changed. Now, it's not the change that saves you. Your change is evidence that you have been saved. And then, sobering statement number 5. There'll be no more chances to be saved after death. Notice verse 23 again. The Bible says, "And then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity." You're either saved in this life or you'll never be saved. It's not annihilation. It's not reincarnation. It's not purgatory. When you die, you either go to heaven or you go to hell. Did you notice it's not that Jesus one day is going to look down there in the pits of hell and say, "Come on up, come on back, come on up, let's see if we can't work out a deal." No, that's not the way it is. I mean, if you die lost, you're going to be in hell forever. I mean, you may go hire the best lawyer there is, but he's not going to get you out of hell. Morgan and Morgan's not going to do you any good then. When you die lost, you're going to hell. You've got to make that decision in this life. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, today is the day of salvation. And then number 6. This may be your last chance to ever be saved. You say, "Preacher, I'm a teenager. I've got a lot of life out there in front of me. I don't want to think about death." Teenagers die. What was it? This probably 6 to 8 months ago now. A teenager who actually was the daughter of her mother. I was her pastor years ago. Within 5 minutes of our home, she died in a car wreck. Teenagers die. Go with me out here to the graveyard today, and I'll show you a lot of tombstones with teenagers' names on them. You say, "Well, I'm a young adult. I don't want to think about death." I mean, we're getting ready to get married, and we've got a lot of plans. We've got a lot of future ahead of us. I don't want to think about death. Go with me out here to the graveyard, and I'll show you a lot of tombstones of young adults. I'm in the middle age of life. I mean, our kids are getting out of the house or getting out of school, and we want to travel. We've got a lot of plans of things we want to do. I don't want to think about death. Go with me out here to the graveyard, and I'll show you many, many tombstones of middle age adults. You say, "Preacher, I'm a senior adult. I know I don't have a lot of years left, but I just don't want to think about death. Brother Charles, this afternoon, tomorrow, you're going to follow a family out here to a graveyard. There are a lot of tombstones out there of senior adults who died. You say, preacher, are you trying to scare me? You got it. You got it. You promise me you won't die? I promise you I won't say anything about death. This may be the last sermon you'll ever hear. This may be the last invitation you'll ever have an opportunity to respond to. Look at that pew where you're sitting at right now. Look at it, right where you're sitting. There's been someone who has said exactly where you are right now. Brother Charles was preaching. The Spirit of God spoke to their heart. They realized they were lost. They realized they needed Christ. And they said no. And they walked out those doors. And they died. And they're in hell today. You need to come to Christ now. Don't put it off. When I was in seminary at Fort Worth, Texas, Southwestern Seminary, my evangelism professor was Dr. Roy Fish. I majored in fish. I took every class that he taught. One of the most godly men that I've ever known. And I'll add this a little bit. You know, he'd come and he'd preach. He didn't teach, he preached in the class. And I'd get so wrapped up listening to him preach. You know what I mean? And I wouldn't be taking notes. And then he'd give those tests. And everything he was preaching was on those tests. And many, many times, he'd give his testimony in the class. And he said, as a young boy, about 8 or 9 years old, the Spirit of God spoke to him and he realized that he needed to be saved. And he went forward in one of our large Baptist churches, took the pastor by the hand, and in essence said, I want to be saved. And the pastor, in essence, responded back and said, Roy, we've been praying for you. Placed him on the front pew, filled out a church membership card, baptized him that next Sunday. Still lost without Christ. He said several years passed by. He was an older teenager. And again, the Spirit of God was dealing with him and convicted him that he'd really never been saved. And again, he went forward to that large Baptist church, took that pastor by the hand, and he said, I want to be a Christian. And in essence, the pastor said again, well, Roy, hallelujah! Placed him on the front row, filled out another church membership card, baptized him the next Sunday, still lost without Christ. Several years passed on by. He went off to college, made his way home one Sunday. And again, the Spirit of God began to convict him that he had never been saved. And again, he went forward in that large Baptist church. And again, he took the pastor by the hand and in essence said, I need to be saved. I need to become a Christian. In essence, the pastor said, well, praise the Lord, Roy. Filled out another church membership card. Was going to baptize him the next Sunday. Still lost without Christ. He said he went back to school that next week. So troubled, so much turmoil in his heart. And he said one evening he walked out on the front porch of the little house where he lived there on campus. And he said the words of the old song came to his mind, only trust him, only trust him. And he said there on that front porch, he said, I turned my face toward heaven. And he said, I lifted up my hands toward God. And I cried out and I said, oh God, every ounce of me, every inch of me, I now trust you. to save my soul. And he said when he did that, the salvation flooded his heart. One time, two times, three times, he went forward in the church. But it was not until he personally trusted Christ that he was saved. Let me ask you, could that be what happened to you? I mean, you walk down a church aisle, you've taken a pastor by the hand, you've nodded your head to a few questions, you had a church membership card filled out, you got baptized, you joined the church, but you've never trusted Christ. You've never been saved. You are religious, but lost. And I'm going to plead with you. I'm going to beg you, come to Christ today. Come to Christ today. Come to Christ today. He'll save you. He'll save you. Yes, he'll save you. And then when you die, you'll have the assurance that you're going to spend an eternity with Jesus in heaven forever and forever. Amen and amen. I'm going to ask you if you will to bow your heads. Close your eyes. Every head bowed and every eye closed. And I want to ask you that question. Do you know for certain, if you died this very moment, that you'd be with God in heaven? I'm not asking you, are you 99% certain? I'm asking you, are you 100% certain, if you died this very moment, that you'd be with God in heaven? I'm not asking you, did you walk down a church aisle? I'm not asking you, did you get baptized or sprinkled or confirmed? I'm not asking you, did you join a church or some type of emotional experience? But I'm asking you, do you know that you know there's been a time and a place in your life that you can go back to where you repented of your sin and you trusted in Jesus alone to save you? And you know for certain, if you were to die this very moment, you'd be with God in heaven. If you can say, yes, I know that. No doubt about it. I know that. I'm going to ask you, if you will, just lift your hand up as a testimony. Just lift it up. Now, don't lift it unless you know it. But if you know it, hold it up there just for a moment. Now, don't lift it unless you know it. But if you know it, hold it up there just for a moment. The Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Okay, thank you. God bless you. Now, there are many, many of you today that did not lift up your hand. And I want to say to you, thank you. Thank you for being honest. Because before you'll ever get saved, you've got to get honest with yourself. And you've got to get honest with God. But there's no reason for any person to walk out of this room today not knowing for certain that when you die, you're going to be with God in heaven. And I'm going to ask you, if you did not lift up your hand, or some of you who perhaps even lifted up your hand, but you say, preacher, to be very honest with you, I don't know for certain. This is something I've struggled with for a long time, and I really need to get it settled. And so I'm going to ask you, if you did not lift up your hand, or you just don't know for certain, I'm going to ask you, let me lead you in a prayer right where you're sitting right now. You may want to pray out loud. You may want to pray silently. But the main thing is, you pray it in your heart, pray it to God, and really mean it. Now, just saying the words won't save you. You've got to mean it from your heart. Let me lead you in that prayer right now. You may be a young person. You may be an adult. You may even be a church member. But you need to get it settled once and for all. Do away with the doubts. Let me lead you in that prayer right now, right where you're sitting. Get it settled. Do away with the doubts. Pray with me right now. Pray with me. Make this your prayer. Understand, you're not praying to a man. You're praying to God. Let me lead you in that prayer right now. Pray with me. Pray with me and say, God, I know you love me. I know Christ died for me on the cross. I know Christ came out of that grave and he's alive. But God, I have sinned against you and I'm lost and I cannot save myself. God, forgive me of all my sin. Jesus, come in my heart right now and save my soul. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me. I'm going to live for you the rest of my life. Now I'm going to ask every one of you who asked Jesus to save you just then, the best you knew how, I'm going to ask you, if you will, just open your eyes, look up here at me. I'll not come to you. I'll not embarrass you. But I want to ask you three questions. I promise you, I won't come to you. Just look up here at me if you prayed that prayer. Look up here at me. Did you pray that prayer? I'm not going to come to you. Did you pray that prayer? Okay. Others there in the back, did you pray that prayer? Yes, sir. Amen. Over here, did you pray that prayer? Over here, did you pray that prayer? Sweetheart, did you pray that prayer? Amen. Over here? Okay. Now, those of you who prayed that prayer, look up here at me. Promise. I promise you I won't come to you. Okay? I want to ask you three questions. Look up here. Number one, do you know God loves you? Do you know God loves you? Do you know God loves you? There in the back, you know God loves you. Do you know God loves you? Do you know God loves you? Do you know God loves you? The Bible says, for God so loved the world. That means God loves you. He really does. He loves you. Then let me ask you a second question. You know that Christ died for you on the cross. You know he died for you on the cross. You know he died for you on the cross. You know he died for you. You know he died for you. Sweetheart, you know he died for you. You know he died for you. The Bible says that God showed his love to us while we were yet sinners, that Christ died for us. You know what that means? That means if you were the only person, if you were the only person, if you were the only person, you're so special that Jesus would have died just for you. Isn't that good? Isn't that good? You're that special. He'd have died just for you. Then let me ask you a third question. This is real important. Are you ashamed of Jesus? You're not ashamed of him, are you? You're not ashamed of him, are you? You're not ashamed of him, are you? You're not ashamed of Jesus, are you? You're not ashamed of him. You're not ashamed of him. Oh, listen. Jesus is not ashamed of you. He went to the cross and he openly, publicly died for you. And I'm going to ask you to do something this morning. Brother Charles is going to come stand here at the front right now. In a moment, I'm going to ask you to just come stand in front of the pastor. By you coming, you're saying, I'm not ashamed of Jesus. You're not ashamed of him, are you? You're not ashamed of him. You're not ashamed of him. You're not ashamed of him, are you? You're not ashamed of him. I promise you, he's not going to embarrass you. All he's going to do is just have a word of prayer with you. Okay? Share a few things going to help you. I promise you, you don't have to give a speech. Trust me, okay? Won't have to give a speech. I promise you that. But by you coming, you're saying, I'm not ashamed of Christ. So I'm going to ask every one of you who asked Christ to come in your life just then, just stand up right now. Walk right here to the preacher. Come on. Come on, guys. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. All over the building. Come on. Amen. Come on. Walk right here to the front. Amen. Amen. Just walk right here to the preacher. Come on. Amen and amen. Others, come on. Others in the back, come on. Come on. Others, real quick. Anyone else, come. 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 How about it? Don't let the devil cheat you. Don't be ashamed of Christ. Step out. Come. Now, you may be here and you've not yet made that decision. But you say, I need to make it. And I need someone to explain to me more what it means to be saved. You come today and we'll take an open Bible and show you how to be saved. We'll explain more what it means to be a Christian. You come. Pastor will be here. I'll be here. You come. Will you do it? Right now. Step out. Come. Let's stand. Let's begin to sing. And as we sing, others need to come. Come on. Step on out. Come. Come. Come on.
How deep come. The Father's love for
come.
Us.
Come.
How vast. Beyond beyond all measure.
Come.
That he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turns his face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory.
Amen. Look up here just for a moment. Others that need to respond. There's others that indicated a moment ago that you trusted Christ. Listen, don't be ashamed of Jesus. He's not ashamed of you. Man, you're special to him. He loves you. Amen? Step out. Now, I know we've done this here before, I think, through the years, but it didn't hurt you then. It won't hurt you now. I'm going to ask you to do something. I'm going to ask you to turn to that person you're standing next to. Your right, left, maybe your husband, maybe your wife, son, daughter, may even be the preacher, maybe a deacon, Sunday school teacher, maybe a total stranger. I want you to turn to them all across the aisle. Don't let anyone be left out. I want you to look at them. I want you to ask them this question. Boom! Amen. Listen. Some of my East Tennessee mountains coming out of me. I want you to turn to that person you're standing next to, and I want you to look at them. I want you to ask them this question. Do you know for sure if you were to die right now, do you be with God in heaven? Listen to their answer. Now, if they can say, yes, I know that, give them a great big old bear hug. Jump up and down, praise God together. But if they cannot say, yes, I know for certain, put your arm around them and say, listen, I'll walk down there with you. Let's get it settled today. Will you do it? Turn to them right now. Don't let anyone be left out. Brother Charles is still going to be here at the front. There's others need to come. Come on. Step out. Anyone. Let's sing. Come on. Come on. Come on. Right now. Come. Come.
Behold the man upon a cross.
Amen. Come. Come.
My sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath has brought me life. Oh, I know that it is finished.
Come, come,
I
come.
Will not boast in anything.
Come.
No gifts, no power, no. Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection. Why should I gain from his reward? I cannot give an answer, but this
you know, when God's moving, you don't want to leave either. Amen? I promise you, let the Methodists, they're going to get in front of you anyway, so let them go and get in front of the line there at the restaurant somewhere. But see, God's still moving. Amen? and others need to respond. You may be here and you say, "Preacher, I know I'm saved, but I've got a son, I've got a daughter, I've got a grandson, I've got a granddaughter. Man, I'd love to see them get saved." You know, let me promise you this, God will answer the prayer of a praying mama. You ought to answer the prayer of a praying dad. Amen? The altar's open. Begin to pray for them. Commit yourself to share Christ with them. You're going to see God do a work. Amen? And amen. Brother Charles, may I go a little bit further? Is it okay? We saw miracles in Ethiopia. God's not just a miracle worker in Ethiopia. He still does it here. He is Jehovah Rapha. We saw the dumb talk, didn't we? We saw the blind see, didn't we? We saw the lame dance. God still does the same thing in America. Now, I know we Baptist. Somehow we have the idea that's for the other people. Our God is God. And you may be here today and you're going through some sickness. And you need a touching hand of God. You need healing. He'll do that. Listen, we'll be glad to pray for him, won't we? Be glad to pray for you, anoint you. You come. Whatever it is, step out. Will you do it? Pastor is still going to be here at the front. Let's sing. Come on. This is for you. Step out. Come.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Let's sing it, come on.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Amen. 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 Look up here. You know what heaven's doing right now? Heaven's having hootenanny. I mean, heaven's rejoicing. You know, we need to join in on that. Don't you think so?
Sure.
I mean, the Bible says when we get to heaven that we're going to shout, amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Isn't it a blessing to have the Whitts with us? Thank you so much, Don. Thank you for your tremendous leadership in the lives of Southern Baptists and in the life of the churches you speak at and that you share the gospel and in the way that you work to share the gospel around the world. It is an honor to call you friend, for sure. If you would like to sow into the ministry of Don and Rosita Whitt, there's all kinds of ministry callings for many pastors and preachers and teachers. The congregations they minister to provide an income for them. That's scriptural. And it's also scriptural for the congregations of the churches that an evangelist or Bible teacher will visit to provide them just a gift from us to them for their ministry and for their teaching. So listen, if you would like to sow into that ministry, we want you to know that you'll have the opportunity to do that. Take a love offering, fill it out, whatever the Lord leads you to give, and just leave it with Franklin in the back or at the Welcome Center, and our deacon fellowship, our finance folks will take care of that gift and make sure it gets to the Whitt family, okay? We do have one more incredibly important announcement. Other than that, if you'd like to join us at 2 o'clock today at Hastings to say goodbye to Karen Mitchell, to be beside her family as they lay her to rest, or to be tomorrow with the Kemp family at Horace Ward Cemetery and Funeral Home in Fairburn. On Fairburn. Stockbridge, isn't it? Fairview Road, that's right. I don't know where Fairburn came from. All right, sorry, on Fairview Road. Thank you, Ed. Yeah, up in Stockbridge. We'd love to have you join us tomorrow at 11 there as well, okay? All right, one big announcement about tonight, right?
Please come back tonight. There will be an opportunity for us as a congregation to serve our community here in McDonough. And so we're partnering with the missions team and and the food pantry, and we're going to do a wonderful evening where we're going to pack food boxes together. We're going to pray over them. We're going to pack snack bags and hygiene bags for homeless members of our community who sometimes come by the church office and just want a snack. And someone to talk to. And so we're going to write cards for them. There will be something for everyone to do. There's something for kids to do. There's something for senior adults to do. We have the missions team has spent a lot of time thinking about how we can make sure that everyone can be a part and be involved. And we have dinner for you. You don't have to bring anything. So just come as you are and ready to serve. And we'll see you there at 6 o'clock tonight in the fellowship hall. And that is all we have for you. We hope you have a wonderful rest of your day. God bless you.